Good morning, everybody. How are we this morning? Well rested, enjoyed work. Okay, that'll be the dust. And hopefully we won't get blown away. As soon as we get Robbie started, I'll go and check the tent ropes, make sure we're all safe and secure, and I hope your tents are safe where they are too. But I did want to just thank Robbie this morning for being here. He's been great all week. I've really enjoyed the presentations that I've caught the tail ends of. And yes, I have got the photos of your slides, so that's good. Brett sends his apologies to you. He can't be here this morning. He's actually come down with a camp gift, we'll call it. But Robbie, just on behalf of the conference, we give you this little token as a thank you for more writing. Now, not many people use pens anymore, so we hope that you can get some mileage out of it. At least the ink will stay for a while. But it's a handcrafted pen by one of our former pastors, and he prays over every pen individually before we gift it to people. To encourage their ministry. So, we thank you. Before I let you go, can I pray for you and then we'll go? Father in heaven, Lord, we just want to thank you for the time we're able to spend in your word. And I just want to thank you for the gifting and the skill that you've put into Robbie as he studied your word, particularly through the book of Revelation, as he's unpacked some amazing things this week, some things that have been challenging, things that have got us to think and encourage us and to move us forward, Lord. So we just thank you for the blessing that he is. We thank you that you will be with him in your spirit now, Lord, as he presents to us this morning. In Jesus' name, amen.
Thank you very much. Well, good morning, everybody. Happy Friday. It is the preparation day, and it is good to be with the saints this morning. Before I get started on what is, in my opinion, the most important topic in the book of Revelation, I want to just say I've really enjoyed my time here and the conversations I've had after I've gotten off the stage here. And I appreciate that many of you don't agree with everything that I'm sharing. I've had some conversations that some people don't believe in a close of probation. I believe it is biblical, and I think there is plenty of scripture to support that. And I would encourage you to go back and to study it again. Not because I think that you're wrong and I'm right, but I don't want anyone to experience the consequences of assuming that they've got infinite periods of time. When Jesus seems to be pretty clear that there is a time when the line in the sand is drawn, when he says, that's it, it's finished. And so I appreciate you wanting to come and express your differences of opinion. In fact, I thrive on that. It makes me a better Bible student. But this is a serious topic, the close of probation. I had some good feedback yesterday saying, how dare you say that the three angels aren't the most important part of the book of Revelation? Let me be clear. I am a Seventh-day Adventist pastor. I am a Seventh-day Adventist evangelist pastor, and I believe in the three angels' messages. In fact, if we had more time, I would give you a three-hour presentation, one after the other, on the three angels. But the point I was trying to make yesterday, and I want this to be extremely clear, the most important part of the book of Revelation for you is the message of Laodicea. The three angels' messages will be preached powerfully by a people who have listened to the counsel of Laodicea. That's why for me, in the context of here in this big camp, I made the bold declaration yesterday that the most important part of the book of Revelation today for you is the message to Laodicea. And that's what we're going to unpack in the next 50 minutes. The other thing I wanted to say is, some of you have said, why do you move so much up on that stage? Well, I'm sorry, but I'm just wired this way. So forgive me if it distracts you, but my honest reaction to that question is, there's a lot of poles here, and yesterday there's a bunch of people sitting up there, and they were doing this around the pole trying to see me, so I'd come over here so I could talk to them too. That's my official excuse, and I'm sticking to it. All right, let's pray. Father in heaven, we are excited to once again delve into a life-changing gospel. Thank you that you've given us the book of Revelation, the revelation of Jesus Christ. And as we delve into this last hour together, we pray that the Spirit, once again, that inspired this book, will be here to illuminate our understanding. And we will be challenged, but it's because Jesus wants us saved. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. We looked yesterday and saw that the last book in the Bible is the book of Revelation. It's not the last written book. In fact, the Gospel of John was probably the last written book in the Bible, also written by the same author as Revelation. But thematically, it's the last book. And so we saw, and I've tried to emphasize this over the course of this entire week, the overarching goal of the book of Revelation is for God to see face to face with His beloved children who have rebelled against Him. He wants restoration. And so the last verse, or not the last verse, but the last chapter, and my favorite verse in the last chapter of all the Bible is this: they, the redeemed, shall see His face. And that word face is what, everybody? The front side of God. Then we went back to chapter 3, the other side of Revelation, and we saw this great promise to the church of Laodicea. To him who overcomes, I will grant to what, everybody? Sit with me. Jesus loves you. God the Father loves you, and the longing desire of their heart is that you will sit with them. Amen. So when we come to the book of Revelation, yesterday I showed you how that through my study over the years, I've seen this pattern, and if you overlay the key prophetic milestones, you find a profound sort of visual graphic and layout there. That if you look at our time period between 1844, which is the end of the 2,300-day prophecy, and the close of probation, the point at which there is no more an opportunity for salvation on this side of the second coming, that is the period that has the most information in this book. And so yesterday, which apparently got me into trouble, I asked the question, which of those sections or themes do you think is the most important? And I'm going to say it once again. The most important part is the first time this time period is addressed. Jesus starts talking to us in the letter to the Laodicean church. And it's only after that letter that all the other grand themes that we love and we hold dear, as rightly we should, come. So if you don't grasp the importance of the letter that Jesus is writing to our time period, the rest of it is just grab a bit here, grab a bit there, and shove a bit there to someone's throat, and shove a bit to someone's throat over here, and hope it all works. So again, I say, from the perspective of our salvation, the most important part is the message to Laodicea. And with that being said, let's jump straight into it. Revelation chapter 3 and verse 14. Jesus comes to His beloved church. It's the last period of Christian history. He started it with Ephesus, and He's been watching it all through the millennia, down to the last fragment of time. And this is what He says. He says to the angel of the church of the Laodiceans, write. The word Laodicean, despite what you may think, does not mean lukewarm. In fact, I'm going to make another heretical statement, and I'm going to raise my hand and say, today, I am a Laodicean. And if you don't raise yours, you've missed the point. Laodicea is the time period. It's not the problem. Are you with me? So Laodicean literally just means a people under judgment. Which is interesting because this is the time period that starts after the end of the 2,300-year prophecy, which is a time of judgment. Which is why the first angel, which is in our time period, starts with, fear God, give glory to Him. Why? For the hour of His judgment has come. So Laodicean is the right time in the timeline to be a church under judgment. If you believe in the 2,300-day prophecy, if you believe that Jesus is the Messiah of 27 AD, if you believe all that, which I do, and I hope that you do too, then we are living right now as the people under judgment. Amen. All right, so Jesus comes along and says, here's what I'm writing. And He says, these things says the what word there? The Amen. When do you normally, now I know I'm a little bit of a stirrer when it comes to getting your engagement, but I like it and I think you like it too. You know I love you, even if you are sitting there silent. You know I love you. But I do like to hear feedback because it makes me feel like you're listening. But when do we normally say the word amen? At the end of something. Something has come, been stated or made a point of, whether it's a prayer, whether it's a powerful scriptural statement. And at the end of that, we all go, amen. Because that's the end of the point. We acknowledge it. It's the idea of saying, so let it be. The interesting thing is this word is one of the universal words. I can go to South America and I can preach and they'll say, amen. I can go to Italy and preach and they'll say, amen. I can go to Africa. It's amen. It doesn't matter where you go on the planet. Amen is amen. Now, Jesus starts his letter to the Laodicean church period by saying, amen. This is the end of the Christian era. It started with Ephesus. It went all the way down through the ages. And here it is. This is the amen. So whatever's coming next should be pretty, pretty important because there's nothing after the seventh church. You may not like the seventh church. Sometimes I don't like what's happening in the seventh church. But there ain't an eighth. If you're waiting for the ninth or the tenth, you will be sorely disappointed. This is it. And so Jesus begins by saying, I'm the amen. In fact, it's funny because each of the seven churches, Jesus begins by stating a description about himself that normally is addressing the problem in that church. For example, when he shows up at Smyrna, he says, I am the one who was alive and died, but am alive forevermore. What was the problem about to face Smyrna? Persecution. And so Jesus shows up just exactly as the hope and inspiration that they need to get through that period. Jesus comes along and the first thing he says to our time period is, listen up, this is it. Amen. And then he continues on and says, the faithful and what? True witness. Now sometimes when we study the Bible, we study the Bible like it's a storybook. And what do I mean by that? We read this and go, unto the angel of the church of the Laodiceans, write these things, says the Amen, the faithful and true witness, the beginning of the creation of God. And we sit there for just a second and we go, wow, that's just poetic and that's beautiful and it's magnificent. All right, verse 2. And you get the idea. We move on. We don't actually sit down and digest why did Jesus choose these words. The Bible, or Revelation to be particular, has 404 verses. Of the 404 verses, 60% of those verses are either a direct quotation from the Old Testament or they're an allusion to an illustration or a story or a symbol of the Old Testament. Does that make sense? That means if you want to understand the book of Revelation, you need to understand the Old Testament. Because it's the foundation of 60% of this book. So when you read this statement where Jesus says, listen, I'm the faithful and the what? True witness. Your mind should go, does that appear anywhere in the Old Testament? Because generally the Old Testament explains the ideas and the concepts. So it just so happens that if you go back to the book of Proverbs, chapter 14 and verse 5, the Bible says that a faithful witness, what's it say, everyone? Does not lie. So Jesus shows up to Laodicea and says, hey, amen. This is it. The next thing out of his mouth says, I'm a faithful witness, everyone, which means, code word, I don't lie. Now, when I was a little kid in school, you used to hear things like this. Robbie, you're my best friend, but I can't lie. What came next out of the mouth of my friend was not that he wanted to lie to me, but he was telling me a truth. What kind of truth? A hard truth. And in my case, it was, Robbie, I like you, but I can't lie. Those shoes you got are not cool. My mom couldn't afford the Reeboks of the 90s, and so she bought me the Kmart knockoffs. And they said, we can't lie. We love you, but we can't lie. Those shoes are not cool. And for me, that was a hard truth. It was true that they didn't like him. And the fact that they told me was that they didn't want to lie, but it was a hard truth. When Jesus comes to us as Laodiceans, meaning all Christians from the point of 2,300 days in 1844 to the close of probation, when he comes to us and says, guys, listen to me. I am a faithful witness. I'm not going to lie to you. You better believe that what's coming next in this letter is going to be a what? A hard truth. But remember this. What was the promise to Laodicea? Jesus says, if you overcome it, I will grant you to what? Sit with me on my throne. What's the goal of Jesus to Laodicea? He wants us to sit with him. We're over here in the beginning of this letter. Jesus is over here somewhere on his throne, and he's saying, hey, Laodicea, amen, amen, watch out, this is the last part. By the way, I'm a faithful witness. I'm going to tell you a hard truth. I'm not going to lie to you. Why? Because I want you to... Are you with me so far? So now we move to what was the second term? Faithful witness and true witness. Proverbs 14:25. A true witness, what do? They deliver souls. Jesus says to us, he says, I am a faithful witness. I am not going to lie to you. But I am a true witness, which means I can deliver your soul. Jesus wants to deliver your soul this morning, my friends. He wants you to be delivered. Because the desire of his heart for Laodicea is that they will sit with him. He wants you to sit. He knows how messed up you are right now this morning. He knows it. He knows that you've got this issue and you've got lots of tissues for these other issues. He knows all of that. And he knows that where you are is not where he needs you to be or wants you to be. And so he says, I've got to tell you the hard truth, but don't worry, I can deliver your soul because the longing desire of my heart is that you sit with me. Is that clear so far? So he continues on. And here it comes. He says, I know your works. Remember, he's a faithful witness. He's not going to lie to us. He says, I know you. That should give you encouragement right now. Jesus knows you. And he wants you to know that he knows you. And he says, I know your works. And then he says, and I even know what kind of person you are. I know what kind of deeds you do. I know you. I'm intimately aware of who and what you are. And he says that you are neither cold or hot. I could wish you were cold or hot. So Jesus has just introduced himself as this is the amen. There's nothing else beyond this. I'm a faithful witness. I'm not going to lie to you, even if it is a hard truth. But the reason I'm sharing this is because I want to be a true witness. I want to deliver your soul because the longing desire of my heart is I want you to sit with me. So here's the hard truth, everyone. When Jesus looks at us and he knows us, and it's not in a judgmental way, I don't believe at all for a second. If anything, he is trying to do everything he can to get you on the throne, and it seems like we're indifferent to it. And so Jesus says, listen, there's a bit of a problem, and here's the hard facts. The problem is that you're not hot and you're not cold. That's the problem. Before we go on, let's talk about this hot and cold. I've heard some bizarre interpretations over the last couple of years. I've heard that the hot are the conservatives and the cold are the liberals, and that Jesus doesn't want you to be either. Well, that's a nice application, but that's what we call eisegesis. That's when you put your interpretation into the text, and that always ends up with you being dead. So don't do that. That's not what he's talking about. Let's let Jesus explain what he means, shall we? Cold or hot? The interesting thing with cold and hot is that they're opposites. So if you understand one of them, you should be able to, by logic, understand the other one. So let's have a look. In Matthew chapter 24, verse 12, Jesus says, speaking of the last days, he says, because, what's that word, everybody? Iniquity. Iniquity is a word for sin. There are two main words we have in English for sin, and both of them will get you dead. So don't think one's better than the other or safer than the other. They're both dangerous to your health. One word is iniquity. The other is transgression. Have you heard those two words in the Bible before? Of course. Whenever you read the word transgression, it literally means there is a line in the sand, so to speak, and transgression means the act of crossing over the line. So you were on this side of the line, the right side of the line, and you crossed over the line, and now you're on the wrong side of the line, and that act of crossing over, that's transgression. Is that clear? Now, at an umbrella level, that's sin. Sin is bad news for your health. So transgression is the definition of crossing over, which is sin. Iniquity is also transgression. It's also crossing over, but with one difference. When you read the word iniquity in the Bible, it is always connected to iniquity being found in the heart. For example, in Ezekiel chapter 28, Lucifer sins. But he doesn't just sin. The Bible specifically says, you were perfect in all your ways until what? Iniquity was found within you. When David committed the sin of Bathsheba, it's described as iniquity. And his great prayer of repentance is for iniquity to be removed from his heart. Create in me a what? Clean heart. You see, iniquity is transgression. It's crossing over, but with one subtle difference. It's intentionally crossing over. You know the line is here. You know that you don't cross over it. But iniquity is, I'm going to cross over anyway. The word for this that we would use in English today is rebellion. Rebellion is when you know what the limits of the law is and you choose to cross over anyway because you're a rebel. So what Jesus is describing here is he says, because rebellion, iniquity, will abound. Some translations will say lawlessness. What's lawlessness? It's when you don't care about the law because you are a rebel. Because iniquity or rebellion will abound, watch what he says. The love. The what word did he say? Do you know what the commandments are summarized as? Love to God and love to your neighbor. The Apostle Paul says in Romans chapter 13, he says that love fulfills the law. But Jesus says, speaking of our generation, he says, because there is rebellion, which is the act of willfully crossing the law, he says, the love of many will grow what? So coldness is the result of rebellion. Do you see that? So when Jesus describes cold people, they're rebels. So we go back to Revelation. He makes the case that we're neither cold nor hot. Cold, we have seen in Jesus' own words, is rebellion or unrighteousness, but rebellious unrighteousness. Hot is the opposite of rebellion, and I put on the screen already because I wanted to help you out this morning. What's the opposite of rebellion? Loyalty. If you are not a rebel to the king, you are loyal to the king. Does that make sense? So if you're not on one extreme where you're opposing everything the king is saying and doing and his government, if you're not opposing it as a rebel, then you are a loyalist. You're in favor of the king. You're in favor of his kingdom and his constitution. So Jesus presents in our time period two great opposites. He says, when I look at my people, the good news is that we're not cold. Amen. But the bad news is that we're not, which means loyal. So that means when Jesus looks down, he says, listen, I've got to tell you a hard truth. I'm a true witness. I'm a faithful witness. Don't worry, I want to deliver your soul, but I've got to be straight with you. You are neither rebel, that's great, but you're neither loyal. That's not great. Why is he telling you this? Because the longing desire of his heart is that we sit with him. He wants you to sit with him. He's not trying to keep you out. He's trying to keep you in. So here's the interesting thing. We know what's coming in this passage. He says lukewarm, right? To get lukewarm, you need an equal part of hot and... What's hot? Loyal. What's cold? Rebel. If you have an equal part, you end up with someone who is equally loyal and rebel at the same time. That's lukewarm. That's a really weird position to be in, isn't it? Because how can you be loyal but also a rebel at the same time? It's like bipolar or something. And I love you, but I'll say it anyway because I think it's funny. I've met the bipolar lukewarm people. They're a little bit hot, they're a little bit cold, they're a bit of a rebel, they're a bit of a loyalist. I mean, they're confused individuals. And this is why Jesus says, this is not cool. This isn't going to work. Because where does he want us to sit in Laodicea? What's the goal? On the... What's the throne? The place of ruling the kingdom. You think he wants to let you, you half rebel person, to sit on his throne? He needs loyal people on his throne, not rebels. But the problem is that he looks at us, he goes, I love you. I prayed for each one of you by name 2,000 years ago. I want you on my throne, me, but I need you to be loyal, not to be a little bit rebel and a little bit loyal. I need the full package. You imagine my wife. I've been married for 17 years. Amen. It was a fantastic journey and love story I didn't tell you. But could you imagine my wife waking up one morning going, I'm just so glad that you're a little bit loyal to me and a little bit rebellious to me. It's working out great. Could you imagine that? Of course not. And yet somehow we think that Jesus is okay with this. Yeah, he'll take a bit of rebellion and a little bit of loyal. The great news is right now he is. I'll show you that from the scripture. He is tolerating this. But he's come to us with an urgent plea. He says, so then, because you are what? What's lukewarm? Equal rebellion, equal loyalty to the king. Because you are lukewarm and you're neither cold, you're neither a full-on rebel. That's the good news. But you're also neither fully loyal. That's the bad news. What does he say next? He says, I will vomit you out of my mouth. Now, I have met some Christians who have said to me, how can you believe in the book of Revelation as an inspired piece of literature? I said, because that's where Jesus is. It's the revelation of Jesus. I've seen him. I've met him there. And they say, have you read Revelation chapter 3 and verse 16? I said, absolutely. It's just like John 3:16. It's written by John. It's John chapter 3 verse 16 in the book of Revelation. And they said, that's impossible. This is not the Jesus that I'm following. I said, why is that? Because the Jesus I follow would never speak so harshly to me. He would never say, I'm going to vomit you out of my mouth. That's not the Jesus of the Gospels. I said, well, I want to challenge you on that for a second. In John chapter 3, verse 16, Jesus says, well, to Nicodemus, he says, God so loved the world that he, what? Gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever, what? Should believe in him should not perish. Where do you get the idea that Jesus is interested in saving you? This verse is about saving you. I'll show you what I mean. We're lukewarm according to Jesus. We're not cold and we're not hot. We're not fully rebellious and we're not fully loyal. We're a combination. And he says, listen, I, what's the next word? I what? Has he done it yet? Has he done it yet? No. Jesus hasn't done this yet. So praise the Lord, you're here this morning. This is a future thing. Now, for some of you, it may be tomorrow. I don't know. But this isn't right now. The fact that you're sitting here this morning and reading this verse, there's hope. He says, I will, what? Vomit. Spew, different translations, different words. But the idea is, it's not pretty, right? You're in, and then you go out. That's vomiting. That's spewing. But I want you to notice what Jesus says here. He says, I will. That's the future. It's not this second. You're okay right now, even though you might be equally rebellious and loyal. There's hope right this second. I will vomit or spew you out of my what? So where are we this second? I'm waiting for you over here. These guys got it. Have you got it? Where are we right now, according to this verse? In Jesus' mouth. Amen. You are in His mouth. I am in His mouth. And apparently, you may not know what I'm talking about right now, but don't worry. It has to be a good thing to be in His mouth. Because the consequences of not being in His mouth doesn't look so pretty, does it? So, what's He talking about? Why is He saying it's important for us to be in His mouth and not be vomited out of His mouth? The next verse tells us. If we go back to chapter 3, we're in chapter 3 already, if we go back to verse 5, the previous churches, He says something interesting. He says, "He who overcomes shall be clothed in white garments, and I will not," what's the next word? "Blot out his name from the book of life." Here's the great news. Your name is in the book of life. Amen? Remember what I said. Jesus is not trying to get you out of heaven. He's trying to keep you in there. Some of you have a really weird picture of God, and I hope that by the time you finish Revelation, you'll start to see that God loves you. He's not waiting for you to do some amazing thing so that He'll start loving you. He loved you while you were yet a sinner. Jesus didn't come and die on the cross so the Father looked down and go, "Well, now I love Robbie." No, God loved Robbie while I was yet a sinner. That's why He sent Jesus. So notice what it says. "I'll not blot out His name from the book of life, but I will," what's the next word? This is Jesus speaking. "I will confess His name before the Father and before the angels." You see, in the previous church, the followers of Jesus, they've got their name in Jesus' mouth. And Jesus is confessing the name before the Father and the angels. And that act of confessing your name before the Father and the angels, that's what we call, from the biblical teachings of the Old Testament, we call that intercession. So Jesus is interceding. He's paid all the price for you. He's gone up there and He's just like, "These people are going to be with me." And He's telling the angels. You imagine those poor angels. They've seen your life. "Are you sure, Jesus? I mean, Robbie, he did some messed up things. You want Him to be here with us?" Jesus says, "Yes, I want Him there." And they go, "But He's a little bit loyal and He's a little bit rebellious." He says, "Don't worry, there's time. He's come to Big Tent 2023, South Queensland, and He's hearing something." The longing desire of Jesus' heart is that Robbie will sit with Him, that you will sit with Him. And so He confesses our name to the angels, not to convince them that we're good enough to come in, but to convince them that we love Jesus enough to stay in. Are you with me? So here's the problem with what Jesus just said, though. If we are in the mouth of Jesus and Jesus is interceding for us, and He's presenting us as saying, "These are my guys and girls. They're going to be in my kingdom, on my throne with me." If He says, "Listen, we've got to sort out this rebellion in you and this facade of loyalty, this lukewarmness. We've got to sort this out, because if we can't sort it out in time for the amen, then I'm going to have to what?" Which means intercession ceases. Which means your probation has closed. This is the most important part of the book of Revelation, I maintain. The three angels are great because the people who listen to this and they go, "I'm all in, Jesus," they're the ones that says, there was another angel flying in the midst of heaven, and it says, possessing the everlasting gospel. And they're preaching it to all the world. Three angels is super important. But it's got to be carried by someone. It's got to be possessed by someone. And do you think the rebels are going to go around, "Yeah, fear God, everyone, while I'm rebelling"? So confession is being in the mouth of Jesus. If your name is out of the mouth of Jesus, confession ceases and so does your probation. But the good news is, where are you right this second, everyone? You are in Jesus' mouth. Amen. Your name is in the book of life. Amen. Let's let Jesus do everything He can do to keep us there. Amen. Let's come back. Verse 17 of chapter 3 later, see, it says, because you say, I'm rich and have become wealthy and have need of nothing and do not know. Notice the contrast. Jesus says, listen, I know you. I know you better than you know yourself. Some of you will come up afterwards, I'm sure, because I've had it many times before, and come up and say, listen, I'm a good person. I've been a deacon in the church for the last 20 years. I've been a head elder for the last 30, 40, 50, 60 years. I've given millions of dollars in offering and project fundings, as well as tithe. I even double tithe. Awesome. I love that, because that shows you're loyal. But now the problem is Jesus says, well, I know your heart, and your heart's a rebel. So we don't even know who we are. We always think the lukewarm person's the person next door to us. It's definitely that person I don't like on the nominating committee. They're definitely lukewarm. We don't even recognize it. This is why Jesus says, I've come to give you the hard truth. I'm your counselor here today. I've come because I want to deliver your soul. He says, you don't even know that you are, notice this, wretched, miserable, poor, blind, and naked. Five things. I hope right now you're going, wow, where does that appear in the scriptures? Because Jesus isn't just going a whole bunch of negative things to make you feel really bad this morning. He's not saying, look, you guys are a bunch of rebels at heart, but you look like you're loyalist on the outside, but you're a bunch of no good, stinking, downright, outright scoundrels. He's not just throwing a whole bunch of descriptions at us. There's a reason why he mentions in this order, wretched, miserable, poor, blind, and naked. Let's have a look real quick in the time we have left this morning. Wretched. This appears one other place in the entire English translation of the Bible. It's in the book of Romans chapter 7. You know the chapter that you all understand completely. Do you know Romans chapter 7? Oh, wretched man that I am. You know the struggle that we see Paul communicate there, and half of us are arguing that Paul is not converted and that's what he struggles about. And the other half of us are arguing that Paul is converted and that's just the way it is. And the rest of you are going, I don't have a clue what they're talking about. I can identify, I can relate, but I don't understand what it's talking about. We're not going to talk about that today, but you're all wrong. Put it that way. I'm being nice, okay? I'm not trying to be picky. So in Romans chapter 7, verse 24, when Paul describes his horrible condition, and it is horrible, he ends by saying, oh, wretched man that I am, who can deliver me from this body of death? The problem in Romans 7, without getting into the debates on either side of the theology of it, the problem is this. The person of Romans 7 knows what right is, yes? But is doing the opposite, which we would call now rebellion or iniquity or cold. So Jesus comes along in Revelation and he just happens to drop this word. Now remember, wretched is coming from English, but he drops the same idea that Paul is using there in Romans chapter 7. So what's a wretched condition in Laodicea? It's when you know what the right is, but you've got no ability to do it. You want to do it, but you're not doing it. Ever been like that before? Of course you have. I've met wretched people. I've been wretched in my life in this movement. And you can normally meet them on a Sabbath morning because they're not happy. And I'm being deadly serious because the very next word is miserable. When you know what the kingdom of heaven is like, what the definition of loyalty looks like, and then you find yourself not able to live like that, you feel wretched. Because you, in your heart, there's a part of you that wants to be loyal to the king, but you don't have any strength to do it. You've tried your best, you've eaten your sanitarium, you've done your whatever you're going to do, you've tried to dress right, eat right, listen right, all those right things like the Buddhists do, but you're finding it keeps failing you. Jesus knows this, and he has great compassion for us. And then he says, but the problem is that leads to being miserable. Amen? Have you met some miserable Laodiceans? And I mean like people under judgment? Absolutely. Most of us are miserable. Why? Because misery, according to Paul, in 1 Corinthians 15, verse 19, he says this, talking about the death of Jesus and the resurrection of Jesus, says, if the dead do not rise, then is not Christ raised. And if Christ be not raised, your faith is what? In vain. Yet ye are yet in your sins. This is Old King James's particular slide. then they also, which are fallen asleep in Christ, are perished. If in this life only we have hope in Christ, we are of all men what? What's Paul talking about here? He's talking to the church at Corinth. We've had a lot of theological problems, especially about the resurrections. And they had this belief that when you die, there's no resurrection. And Paul is saying, listen, if there's no resurrection, then Jesus didn't raise from the dead. And if Jesus didn't raise from the dead, then you are still in your sins, because Jesus is the solution to your sin. And then he makes this point. If your faith doesn't have any hope for the future, you're miserable. Are you with me? So what's a wretched person? You know what the standard of loyalty for the king is, but you're finding in your own actions, in your own life, you're living as a rebel. People look at you and go, man, you're loyal. But it's in the inside that matters, not the outside. You came to camp. Amen. You look loyal to the king. You keep the Sabbath. Amen. You look loyal to the king. You keep the right day. You give a tenth of your income back to God. Amen. You look loyal to the king. But what's happening on your heart? If God tells you, listen, what you're doing, whatever you eat, drink, or whatever you do, that's everything in life. What you're doing is not bringing glory to my king and to my kingdom. Are you going, but it's only a little thing? Oh, surely my Jesus wouldn't ask me to do that. That's called rebellion. You may justify it any way you want, but that's rebellion. That leads you to the idea that you have no hope for anything to change in your life. Listen, 20 years ago, I used to do all sorts of silly things. This might be PG, but we'll keep it PG. I used to put things into my body that were not good for my body at all. But I did it anyway. There were words that came out of my mouth that were not good for anyone to listen to. But I did it anyway. There were actions that I did with my body that were not good, but I did it anyway. But I found Jesus. I met him that night. He prayed for me. He showed me my name in Scripture and all that good stuff. And he gave me prophecies to understand intellectually that this isn't a dumb decision based on emotional blind faith. It's logic. There's reason. But then he got me with the emotions and made me cry like a baby because I recognized I needed Jesus. Now imagine if Jesus goes, awesome, now you know, now you believe, now na-di-na-di-na, stay right there and live your miserable life. Imagine that. Imagine after 20 years, I'm standing here and going, well, oops, sorry, I slipped an F word in there, or this word or that word, because that's just what I was before I met Jesus. And meanwhile, I'm doing this, and I'm listening to that, I'm eating that, I'm doing that, doing all these things. You'd go, well, what's the point of you, what? Knowing Jesus. And that's what Paul's point here is. The point of knowing Jesus is it gives you great hope because it solves your miserable life now. Amen? Well, it solved my miserable life. Maybe your life is great. But my life was miserable until I met Jesus. So we are wretched because we know what righteousness looks like, what the loyalty looks like, but we find ourselves being little rebels in our hearts. And then we become miserable because now we don't have any faith to expect anything to change. I find it remarkable that we expect people to change with Jesus' help before we baptize you, but after you baptize, well, you just don't have patience. You're one of those people, and that will never change. What kind of Jesus do you serve? Now, that leads us to being what now? If we're miserable, we're wretched, we're miserable, what are we next? Poor. Look what Peter tells us. Well, it's not Peter, Jesus. In Revelation chapter 2, verse 9, he's speaking to the church of Smyrna. He says, listen, you guys have got a really difficult circumstance. You're being persecuted physically. You're being put to death, literally. And he says that I know your tribulation and your poverty. You are poor. You're literally their physical assets were being stolen and taken by the state. So they're poor. But Jesus just slips it in there and says, don't worry though. Because from where I'm standing, your worth is invaluable. You're a millionaire in the Lord. So you're rich. Now, why were they rich? It's because they had faith. Being poor is not having faith. When Jesus says, you're rich, he's not saying, oh yeah, but you got like a trust fund in the background there somewhere sitting and calculating. No, 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 no. He's talking about their faith, a faith that led them to death. He says, you guys are rich. And as you go through Scripture, poor spiritually is always an absence of faith. And being rich spiritually is always the abundance of faith. Which makes good sense in this case, because why would we be poor? Because we have no faith. And that's because we're not expecting anything to change. That's what Paul said. That's why we're miserable. We're miserable because our faith doesn't think anything's going to change. And because that faith doesn't do anything, it's not valuable. So we're what? But what do Laodiceans think? They think that we are rich and increased with many goods. So that's poor. What's the next one there, everyone? Peter tells us in 2 Peter chapter 1, verse 9, he says, "For if these things be in are yours and abound, you will neither be barren nor unfruitful in the knowledge of our Lord Jesus Christ. For he who lacks these things is," what's that next word? "Short-sighted, even to blindness," right? So Peter here is in 2 Peter, we call this Peter's ladder. It's a list of virtues that the follower of Jesus attains because of his faith in Jesus. And Peter's saying, if you lack these things, you're really short-sighted, and you actually end up what? Blind. Notice what he then says. "And have forgotten that he was," what's that next word, everybody? "Cleansed from his old sins." What Peter is saying is that a person who is blind spiritually, they met Jesus. Jesus cleansed them from their sins. And then they forgot that Jesus has that sort of power. And they walk on through their Christian walk not expecting anything else to change. That's blind. That leads to having no faith, which makes you miserable, because you know what loyalty is and you ain't living it. At least not entirely. Does that make sense so far, everybody? This is the message to Laodicea. Jesus wants you to sit with him, but he's got to get us out of this problem that we find ourselves in. We find that we want to be loyal to his kingdom, but we're not able to do it. No matter how hard we try, how many courses we attend, how many prayer groups we go into, small groups and workshops and all this stuff, we're still miserable because we have no faith, we're poor, and that leads us to being blind and forgetting that he even had the power to free us in the first place. Are you with me still? What's the last one on the screen, everyone? Naked. Nakedness in the Bible, except for one place, is always a bad thing. The only place that appears to be a good thing is when Adam was with his wife before sin. After that, there are a whole bunch of verses. Here's some examples. Genesis 3, they were naked and they were ashamed. Then Leviticus 18, nakedness is considered an abomination. In what's the other verses I got there? In Acts chapter 19, we have a bunch of disciples trying to cast out some demons. They were not real disciples of Jesus. They're trying to cast out some demons. The demons came out and then beat up these wannabe disciples and left them naked. In Mark chapter 5, the demoniac is naked amongst the tombs. Isaiah chapter 64 tells us that our righteousness is like filthy rags. But here it says you don't even have that. If you don't have filthy rags, guess what you are? You're naked. And so nakedness in a biblical context paints the idea of being controlled and ashamed by sin and Satan. This is God's loved people, the beloved people of the Laodicean period of church history. Jesus loves us. He loves us. He wants us to sit with him on his throne. But he says, listen, I've got to tell you some hard facts here. You guys are not in a good position. You're in my mouth right now. Don't worry. I'm still confessing for you. I'm still interceding for you. Your name is still in the book of life. But I've got to tell you some stuff, because we've got to change some things, because I can't keep this going on if you don't get out of this situation. You're controlled and ashamed. You've forgotten the fact that I got the power to free you. That leads you not to have any more faith or confidence in the future. That means you're miserable because you're not expecting anything, which leads you, once again, in a wretched condition. And Jesus doesn't like this. He hates that we live like this. This is why he wrote the letter. So what's the solution? I think that's I've got 13 minutes for the solution. The very next verse, Jesus comes out and says, listen, remember he's a true witness. What's a true witness do? Delivers our souls. So he's told us the faithful part. He hasn't lied to us. He's told us the facts. We want to be loyal, but inwardly in our hearts, in the depths of our hearts, in our recesses of our minds, we are still a little bit rebellious. That affects us, because then we feel like, well, I don't feel like this is good when I'm being a rebel to God, and so we suppress that, and we go, well, that's just how it is, we're wretched. But then we're miserable because we don't think it's ever going to change, or can change, and we forgot that he had the power to save us in the first place, and that leads us blind, feeling naked and ashamed before God. But Jesus doesn't want to leave us there. That's not what... Jesus is a Savior. By the way, everything I've described right there is what our Christian life is like without Jesus working in it. So what's the solution? Jesus comes along and says, I counsel you to buy. I met some other people. I meet a lot of people. Some people say this verse is not very gospel orientated. I say, really? Why is that? Well, the gospel is a free gift. And that's saying you need to buy. I said, that's a good observation. There's just one little thing. You're reading it in English. And Jesus wasn't speaking English. But the idea is still the same. Here's what the original thought means. In the old days, we might go back to that at some point in the future, but I'm not sure. But in the old days, you didn't buy things, you exchanged things. I'd give you a cow, you give me a chicken. Probably a bad deal, but you get the idea. We exchange things. And so what Jesus is using this idea here, this principle, that for the situation we're in to improve, we need to exchange things with him. Does that make sense? So let's notice what he says. I counsel you to exchange or to buy from me, what's the word? Gold, refined in the fire. For what purpose? That you may be... Now, what's our problem according to Jesus? One of our problems. We've got five problems. What's one of them? We're poor. And what was poor all about? Having no faith. Jesus' first solution is, you got to give me the faith you think you have, and I'll give you faith that I have. Does that make sense? Can you borrow? Oh, no, you're doing a camera thing. Can you come for a second? I want to use you for an example. I hope this is okay. I just got this. Let's have a look at it. Wow, that's nice. Thank you. All right. So you want to hold that for me. So this is where Jesus is standing in the equation, and he is holding what? Thank you up the back. He is holding gold. What kind of gold? Gold that has been refined or tried in the fire. Jesus has it there, right? Now, I've got something. I'm Robbie, by the way. Nice to meet you, everybody. I'm holding here what I believe to be faith. I call this, I have faith in... Okay, you're going to have to be with me. I don't want to upset anybody again. I've done enough this week. But please, just go along with me here. I have faith in Jesus, all right? Jesus says, hey, for this to work, for you to get out of your situation, we need to do a little exchange here. Now, the faith that I have in Jesus, guess what I think that's going to do for me? I think that when my trials come, I'm going to overcome the world. But the problem is that we've already seen from Jesus' account of my life, I am wretched. I am miserable. I'm poor. So my faith, what I think I have in Jesus, isn't actually bringing any change. All right, good. You got it. So Jesus says, listen, I have what? Gold. What is that? Faith. What is it? What's been done to it? Refined. When was Jesus' faith tried in the fire or refined in the fire? When? First time, when? The wilderness, very good. The first time is in the wilderness. Remember that? The faith of Jesus is tried in the wilderness. When's the next time? Gethsemane. It's tried in Gethsemane. So here we have Jesus holding faith. Listen to this carefully. I love this. It's a hymn. Faith that has overcome. You don't know that hymn? I thought you would. You've got gray hair. Nah, just kidding. Faith that overcame the world. That's Jesus' faith. What do I have? I have faith in Jesus. So now I come over here, and Jesus says, I want you to do an exchange with me. So I've got to give him something. So he's going to take my gold and I take his gold. And now what am I holding? The faith of Jesus. Have you read that anywhere in the Bible? I'm excited, but I'll contain myself. So now I have the faith of Jesus that has been tried in the fire. It's been tested in the fire. Did I earn it? Nope. I just gave up something. I had to surrender something to get this. Because apparently I can't have this and this at the same time. I got to give up something in order to have what Jesus wants me to have. Does that make sense? So now I've got the faith of Jesus. All right, thanks very much. You can sit down. Thank you very much. Round of applause for our volunteer there. So faith, and then he says, and white raiment, that the clothes that you may be clothed and the shame of your nakedness may not be revealed. What's one of our other problems? Nakedness. And nakedness is that we're controlled and we're ashamed. So he's going to do what? Clothe us. So where's the clothing come from? Jesus. Where does the gold come from? The faith. Where's it come from? Jesus. What did you bring to the table? Filthy rags. Well, you think you have filthy rags, but you're actually butt naked. And when you show up, what else do you think you have? I have gold. Look at me. I've been a pastor for 15, 16, 18, 30 years, a conference president, elder, deacon, whatever. Jesus goes, that's great. Give it to me. I'll give you something better. And most of us are going, no, but my faith, it's my faith. So Jesus gives us the faith. Jesus gives us the white raiment. Then he says, and anoint your eyes with eye salve that you may what? See. All right. I've got 5 minutes left. We're going to have to do this really fast. So the counsel is three things. We got five problems. Jesus has got three solutions. Number one, gold. Number two, white raiment. Number three, eye salve. Gold, 1 Peter chapter 1 verse 7 tells us that the trial of faith is more valuable than what? So what's the gold represent? I've already said it. Gold represents faith. Whose faith? Jesus's faith. If you think you will ever have a difference in your life because of your faith, you are greatly mistaken. You'll end up miserable, wretched, poor, blind, and naked. Just like we all are today. But if you have the faith of Jesus, something changes. What's the white raiment here? Revelation chapter 19, verse 8, the Bible says, and to her it was granted to be arrayed in fine linen, clean and bright. For the fine linen is what? The righteousness of the saints. Jesus is giving us the white raiment. But what's white raiment? Righteousness. Whose righteousness is Jesus giving us? His. What's he doing with yours? You don't have any. You understand you don't have righteousness? No matter how hard you try, you will not have it because it comes from Jesus. Are you with me? I love you. Thank you. The third point, eye salve. Now here's where we're going to go on a little detour. Eye salve. 1 Samuel chapter 9 says this. The servant answered Saul again and said, look, I have here at hand 1/4 of a shekel of silver. I will give that to the man of God to tell us our way. You're saying, Robbie, I don't get it. That's all right. The next verse will explain it. Formerly in Israel, when a man went to inquire of God, he spoke thus. Come, let us go to the what, everyone? Seer. For he who is now called a what? Prophet was previously called a seer. Here's what the Bible is trying to tell us. At some point, prophets were not known as prophets. They were known as people who can see, or seers, the doers of see. So a prophet is one who can see. Now when we talk about a prophet, there are two functions of prophets. The first one we all know, and this is the first one we think of. We think of prophets revealing the future. This is things like we talked about in the first couple of days. The book of Daniel, book of Revelation, various other prophecies. Predicting future events. That's one of the works of a prophet. But the second work of a prophet is very interesting. This is an illustration of Nathan the prophet appearing before King who? David. King David in this illustration is sitting where? On a throne. Who is he a king for? Yes, for Israel, but a king for who? Who chose him? God. So he is a representative of who? God. That's David. Would you say he is loyal? Okay, look at the picture. Would you say he's loyal? Yes. He is sitting there, he is playing his harps, he's composing amazing new worship songs every day. He's got deep thinking into his relationship with God. He is loyal to the king. Amen. Now, he's sitting there on the throne, and one day, God sends a prophet up to him, and the prophet says, hey, I've got a testimony for you. What word did I say? I've got a testimony for you. What's a testimony, Robbie? A testimony is a little story. Here's the story. One day, there was a really rich man, and he had a friend over, and when he came over, he had nothing to feed him. Actually, he did, but he decided to go to his neighbor next door and take his little sheep or little lamb and kill it, dress it, and feed it to his guest. David, what was his response to that story? He said, what on earth? That is unfair. That is not just. That is not righteous. In fact, the man who did this, let him die. Does he look like he is loyal to the kingdom of God? Absolutely. He worships on the right day at the right location. He says the right words. He sings the right song. Everything looks legit. The problem is, we know the secret. What was the secret? He had had a little night stroll over the top. You know the story, right? Let me ask you a question. Is it just me, or does David seem like really dumb?
Dumb
about what? Dumb when he's talking to Nathan the prophet. I mean, the event was dumb too, don't get me wrong. But when Nathan shows up and tells him this story, when I read the story, I know exactly what Nathan is talking about. Don't you? I mean, he's not talking about a sheep, is he? Is he? No, he's talking about a lady. And he's talking about not just some rich guy, he's talking about David. But David, listen to me carefully, David is so blind that he can't see what? His own heart. Even in the face of a prophet sharing a testimony, he can't even see that it's him. That despite all of his outward loyalty to the king, inwardly, he broke just about every commandment there is and makes him a rebel. So David was lukewarm. He looked righteous. He looked loyal. But he was lukewarm because he was a rebel on the heart. And it took, get this, it took a prophet to show up at the right time with a testimony for his eyes to go, that's me. Now, when that happened, what was his response? When David recognized the story, because Nathan, if you don't know the story, Nathan then turns to David and says, after David says, let that man die, Nathan goes, you are the man. At that second, his eyes were opened and he could see. When he could see his own heart through the work of a prophet, what did he do? He repented and he will be in the kingdom. Because the longing desire of Jesus' heart is that David will not be lost, but that he will sit with him. So he sends the prophet to his person. Look, David loved God, don't get me wrong. But he was just as equally a rebel as he was a loyalist person in this particular instance. So the prophet comes, opens his eyes, and now he sees his condition. And he's grateful for it. And he writes the psalm that you and I turn to every time we mess up. Amen? The longing desire of God's heart is to save us. Because he wants us to sit with him. So the first work of a prophet is to reveal the future. The second work of a prophet is to reveal true motives of the heart. What's the problem with us as lukewarm Laodiceans? We can't see. See what? Oh, see that pastor's messed up. See that elder's messed up. That women's ministries leader is messed up. That we can see everybody else's problems, but guess what we can't see? We can't see our heart. And if we could, we would know that we are rebels. What do you think Jesus wants you to see this morning? He wants you to see where you are a rebel. Hope is not lost. You're still in His mouth. He's still confessing for you. But He wants you to be free of your wretched condition, free of your miserable condition. He wants you to be happy. He wants you to see a future with Him. So the work of a prophet. We all know these passages. Surely Lord God does nothing unless He first reveals His secrets to His servants, the prophets. I've noticed a pattern in the Bible. I'm sure you've seen it too. Before every major event, God sends prophets. Sometimes male, sometimes females. He sends prophets before the flood, Noah, before the Exodus, Moses, before the Babylonian captivity, a whole bunch of them. After the captivity, He sends some. Before the baptism of Jesus, before the fulfilling of the 70-week prophecy, He sends a prophet, John the Baptist. And before the second coming of Jesus, right before that close of probation period, probably even in that last period of 1844 to the close of probation, He's probably going to send some prophets. Because our problem is we can't see. But we think we do. In fact, this is how Revelation puts it. We said it the other day. The remnant, or the rest of our offspring, who keep the commandments of God and have what? The testimony of Jesus Christ. In Revelation 19:10, it says, the testimony of Jesus is the spirit of prophecy. It's the gift to see. Now, some people have told me over the years, Robbie, that's a bit strange. You think there's going to be prophets. I don't think it's strange because every time God does something amazing, He sends prophets. Well, how do we know if there's a true prophet or a false prophet? Good question. The Bible gives us answers. We can test them on what they claim as a prediction, whether it comes to pass. We can see if their message is in harmony with the Word of God. We can see if it edifies the church. We can see if it exalts Jesus. We can see if the prophet themselves bear good fruit. We can even test to see if there are physical signs associated with that person, even if it is secondary, not primary. So there's no question that we don't have to be guessing if everyone comes. By the way, I've met prophets in my lifetime. They weren't real, they were false, but I've met them. I've met them in three different continents. They come up to me and they showed me a collection of handwritten books about this, a stack this high of predictions and prophecies that God has given them. I sat down and I read them. Not all of them, because I got through about the first book, and it was telling me to do things the Bible taught me to do. But I've met people claiming to be prophets. I don't get scared of prophets. I'll test you. So come and tell me you're a prophet today and we'll have a conversation about testing you. But here's the point. The Bible is clear. God gives prophets to open our eyes so we can see our own conditions. So what are you saying, Robbie? Here's what I'm saying. In my journey that started September 11, 2001, that's led me to here today, it introduced me to this lady. Her name is Ellen White. You've probably heard of her. Some of you may not have. I was introduced to this on a website written by the Seventh-day Adventist Church that claimed that one of their identifying characteristics is that they have the gift of prophecy manifest in this individual, Ellen White. The church also claims that there will be other prophets in the future before Jesus returns, based on the book of Joel. It says there'll be many young women, old men, young men who will receive the gift of prophecy. So the church doesn't believe this is the only one. This isn't our Joseph Smith. Far from it. But this is an interesting challenge for me when I start this journey of trying to find faith and find Jesus and the fellowship of the saints. I did an internet search and I found a lot of websites have a lot of bad things to say about this lady. This is before I even met any of you. And so I thought, well, let me read this. So I went through, there's one website in particular that has 75 reasons why they believe this woman is a false prophet. I thought, let me check it out. So I went through the 75 points. They cite some things that Ellen White writes and then some things that the Bible says and say, see, contradiction, therefore false prophet. Now, if that's true, there are contradictions. It is in fact a false prophet and I would want nothing to do with it. But me, not caring, because I don't have baggage like some of you do, some of you tell me I've been hit over the head by Ellen White all my life. I'm sorry someone hit you over the head with Ellen White, but that's not Ellen White's fault. So I read through these 75 points on this one particular website, and what I found was astonishing. It was a very misleading website from the perspective that they would misrepresent the intent of the passages. By the way, in order to do this exercise, I had to read most of what she had written, which was amazing, by the way. So here's what I found. I found that this lady claims to have received more than 2,000 prophetic visions and dreams, has written over 50 books and lectured on thousands of people in many continents. She had aspects of her ministry of revealing future events, but that wasn't the primary function. I will show you a couple examples of this. I am over time, but I will finish before the next guy starts. This is what it says. It says, not long hence, these cities, she's talking in 1902, these cities will suffer under the judgments of God. San Francisco and Oakland are becoming as Sodom and Gomorrah, and the Lord will visit them in wrath. I read this and I said, that's interesting. Did anything happen to San Francisco and Oakland? Well, it turns out in 4 years from that prediction, this is what the Cincinnati Post posted. 3,000 dead, $300 million lost, San Francisco obliterated. And they show a picture there where all the high-rises of the day are gone. And they weren't high-rises on our scheme of things, but they were nonetheless, that was a lot of damage and destruction. People in that time period recognized that statement as a fulfillment in those earthquakes. I thought that was interesting. Here's another one. In 1905, she makes the claim that God told her that tobacco is a slow and insidious but most malignant poison. The medical professions in 1905 said this person's a crackpot, has no idea what they're talking about. She said, I may be, but this comes from God. It took until 1954 for the American Cancer Society National Board of Directors to publish what they called the Cigarette Report. And notice what the subtitle says, it links cancer to cigarettes. It took more than 50 years for the claim that cigarettes or tobacco causes cancer, which for 50 years was not believed. So either she was a nut job and fluked it, or in fact she did have a revelation from God. The same way I approached the Bible with the book of Daniel, with Babylon, Medo-Persian, all that stuff, I approached it with this stuff. You continue on. She says in 1905 that flesh, as in meat for food, is not the best for food, but its use is now doubly objectable. People are continually eating, I can't even read this, let me get closer. People are continually eating flesh that is filled with tuberculosis and what? And what? Cancerous germs. Tuberculosis, cancers, and other fatal diseases thus communicated. She's making a claim in 1905 that God's telling her eating meat is not a good thing for your health. Now, it's not necessarily a sin, but it's not good for your health. Are you with me? Notice this. She says that you can get cancer through germs. People in her day said, boo-hoo, that's a load of rubbish. We know maths, we know science, we know physics, we know chemistry, and that's just not true. And it wasn't true in science until 1966, a Nobel Prize is won that establishes that there is proven links between viruses causing cancer, validating the claims of this lady's work more than 60 years before. Now, I don't know if this is true. I haven't been able to prove it, but I've heard it a number of times. The claim is that this individual, this researcher, he actually got his idea to do this study based on Ellen White's writing. Now, I haven't yet been able to prove it, but I think it's an interesting story nonetheless. So did she talk about things in the future? Yes, there's many other things that she says that will happen in the future, and they have happened. But the thing that I'm more interested in today in the context of Laodicea is number two. She claims that the majority of her work is for God to reveal our true motives. Let me show you what she says. Testimonies to the Church, Volume 2, page 605. She says, the Lord designs to what? Warn you. To what? Reprove, to counsel through the testimonies. The testimonies are a collection of 9 volumes. Testimonies to the Church, Volume 1 through 9. And they are a collection of letters and writings to individuals, just like Nathan the prophet did. But when you read it, you start to see your own sins and your own heart and your own rebellion in those testimonies. And she claims that God has designed to warn us, reprove us, and counsel us through these testimonies, and to impress our minds with what? The importance of truth of His Word. What's the primary focus? To bring us to His Word. Then it says, the written testimonies are not given to give new light, but to impress vividly upon the hearts of the truths of inspiration already revealed. Does that make sense? So when you pick up these testimonies, they help you see your own heart. Did David know that the commandment said don't commit adultery? Yes. Did he know they said don't kill? Yes. But he needed a prophet to point out and open his eyes up so he would recognize he has to go back to the Word of God. This is what she's claiming her ministry is. To give you testimonies that when you read it, opens your eyes. So that you recognize your need to go back to the Word of God. She continues. Yet, but few of you are obedient to the light given. I hear people say to me, look, I'll just read the Bible and just skip out an Ellen White. Cool. Be like David then. David sitting on the throne, worshiping God, playing his praise songs. He's reciting the Torah. He's reciting the Ten Commandments. And yet he is still lost. And he needed the prophet that God sent to open his eyes, to go back to the Bible, to be saved. So don't read them. I don't care. Well, I do actually. I read them because I don't want to miss anything Jesus wants to tell me. You don't read them. Fine, don't read them. But read your Bible and pray like you have never prayed in your life before to see if you're a rebel. She then goes on and says, additional truth is not bought out, but God has, through the testimonies, simplified the great truths already given. She then goes on and says, and in his own chosen way, brought them before the people to awaken and impress upon their mind that what? All, what to say, may be left without excuse. After David encountered Nathan, it was his point of no return. When you encounter this, it's your point of no return. There's no more excuse. Now, was she a cult leader? Well, I wanted to know that. This is what I found. She says, cling to your Bible as it reads. Stop your criticism in regards to its validity and obey the word, and not one of you will be what? That sounds like a cult leader, doesn't it? Just like one. This is a message to pastors. This is my textbook as a minister of the gospel. This is what it says. Lift up who? You that teach the people, lift him up in your what? Lift him up in your what? Lift him up in your what? Let all your powers be directed to pointing. Oh, I missed it. Anyway, it says pointing the soul to Jesus. Because Jesus is the one that cares about you. He's the one praying for you. He's the one that loves you. He's the one that wants you to sit with him. Here's some books I'd encourage you to read. Desire of Ages. It's a real cult book. It talks about Jesus, his life, his teachings. Next book, Steps to Christ. It's a real cult book. It leads you to Jesus. If you've been a Christian for all your life, I challenge you, read that book and see if you don't find Jesus even more lovely than you thought he was. Christ's Object Lesson. There's a cult book, if ever I saw one. It's the teachings of Jesus' parables. Thought from the Mount of Blessings. Teachings from Jesus. This was the passion of this lady's heart. Lift up Jesus. Point people to Jesus. Here's some others. Interesting facts. As a result of work like this, Ministry of Healing, the Seventh-day Adventist Church has 1,832 hospitals and healthcare centers around the world. This is phenomenal considering this woman was a third-grade educated person claiming to get inspiration from God on how to do the work. It clearly produced some results. Her work in terms of sharing the gospel and preaching Jesus has led us as Seventh-day Adventists to be in 212 of the 235 countries on the planet. Now, that's what it is officially. I can tell you now from first-hand experience, we're in the other ones too, just not officially. Amen. There's something about these writings that are impressing the hearts and minds around the school. Education, another area, huge impact. Congregations, almost 22 million members have followed the teachings of Jesus and led them to this church. So in conclusion, three things. The faith of Jesus, the righteousness of Jesus, and Jesus' prophets. That's the solution to being lukewarm. That's your greatest need in the book of Revelation today, because if you don't accept these three things, you will not be proclaiming three angels. You will not be standing when the rest of the world is falling. I didn't take it off. Someone else did. Put it up. Last slide, guys. Here it is. So here's what we've got in conclusion. The Laodicean church are a people who arrive on the world stage after 1844, the 2300-day prophecy. They have a message of righteousness. Whose righteousness? Jesus' righteousness. By what? By faith. Whose faith? Jesus' faith. And they've also been blessed with something that will open their eyes up, the spirit of prophecy. Friends, there is no other movement on this side of the second coming that ticks those boxes as the Seventh-day Adventist Church does. That's why I'm one of you. Please leave here today and consider opening up the pages of the spirit of prophecy and asking Jesus, Jesus, I don't want to be a rebel. I struggle, I'm wretched, I'm poor, I'm miserable, blind, I'm naked, but I don't want to be lost. And Jesus will say, I've got the solution. Let's pray. Father in heaven, you love your church. You love the people of the church. And we just ask, Jesus, that you would help us not to forget that you love us and you're doing everything you can to keep us in your mouth, to keep us in your book, and to get us on your throne. I pray for my friends here in South Queensland, Big Camp. May they leave here inspired, on fire for Jesus, because we've seen him this week. In his name we pray. Amen. May God bless you all and continue your journey.